We will start our problem with a half circle. Then we will mark the center of this half circle, and from the left radius, we will construct an isosceles triangle which touches the arc of our half circle, as you can see on the sketch. Then, inside our triangle, we will inscribe a circle with the area of 4 squared units. Now we will connect the apex of our triangle with the right vertex of our half circle, and finally, in the upper part of our half circle, in this newly constructed segment, we will inscribe the biggest possible circle, as you can see on the sketch. The question is, can we somehow calculate the area of this inscribed red circle? This awesome problem was presented to me by one of my subscribers who wanted to stay anonymous. So, if you guys want to try this one out for yourself, you can pause the video right now and then come back and check the solution. Alright, so let's solve this one together. For this problem, we're going to use several different properties of a circle and the circular theorems. But let's first start with our inscribed circle inside the triangle. This circle has the area of 4 squared units. And if we label the radius of this circle as small r, we can say that the area of this circle is equal to pi r squared. So we can say that pi r squared has the value of 4. So this is going to be super useful for us later. Now, let's have a look at our triangle. We know that the base of this triangle is actually the radius of our half circle, which we can label as A. But if you notice, the radius of our half circle is also the right leg of our isosceles triangle. This, of course, means that the other leg is also equal to A, so we can conclude that this triangle is actually an equilateral triangle. Now, we have a circle which is inscribed inside an equilateral triangle. So we already have the formula for this. We know that the radius of the circle inscribed inside an equilateral triangle is equal to the 1/3 of the height of this triangle. We also know that the height of the equilateral triangle is equal to the side times root 3 over 2. Now we can substitute the value of h, and we will get the following. Now we can work through this fraction and get that r is equal to a root 3 over 6. Now we can rearrange this a little bit and get that the side a is equal to 6r over root 3. Now, of course, we're going to rationalize this a little bit and get the following. And when we simplify 6 and 3, we will get that the side of our equilateral triangle is 2r root 3, and we're going to substitute this value in instead of a. Now, remember, this also represents the radius of our half circle. Alright, so now let's clear our image a little bit, and let's shift our focus on this radius of our half circle. So, if we mark the center of our inscribed circle on the right, and if we rotate this radius to the center of this circle, we have a line which definitely goes through both centers and touches the intersection point between our small circle and our half circle. We know this for a fact by using the first circular theorem for this problem, which states that if two circles touch each other externally or internally in this case, then their point of contact lies on a straight line joining their centers. And as you can see, this is exactly our case. So this means that this line will definitely touch the contact point between two circles. Now we can just label the radius of our inscribed circle on the right as capital R. Alright, so now let's take a look at this tilted green line. This line also represents the chord of our half circle. So, since we know from the condition of our problem that our upper inscribed circle is the biggest possible inscribed circle, this means that it must touch this chord at the very center, and it will bisect this green chord. So, this will help us greatly, because if you take a look at our radius and this green chord, we can use another circular theorem which states that a perpendicular to a chord drawn from the center of a circle bisects the chord. So, as you can see, this is exactly our case on the left. Because the red line bisects the chord, it means that it would be perpendicular to it. So, the angle between those two lines must be 90 degree angle. Alright, so now let's simplify our image a little bit and let's concentrate on this triangle on the sketch. We will use another circular theorem. This one is called an inscribed angle theorem. It states that if we have an inscribed angle inside the circle, then it will always be half of the measure of the central angle that subtends the same arc. So, if you take a look at the sketch on the left, you can see that the central angle here is 180 degrees. But our inscribed angle that subtends the same arc is up here. So, it must be half of the central angle, which means that this angle must be 90 degree angle. Alright, so now let's go back and let's take a look at our equilateral triangle once again. We know that each angle of the equilateral triangle is equal to 60 degrees, so the angle at the apex of this triangle is 60 degrees as well. Now, we know that the upper angle is 90 degrees, so this means that the remaining part of this 90 degree angle on the right must be 30 degree angle. Now, let's have a look at this shaded orange triangle. This is the right angle triangle with one acute angle of 30 degrees. This means that the other acute angle must be 60 degree angle. Now, remember that radius of our half circle? We rotated it to the center of our inscribed circle on the right, and we got the line with the same length as the side of our equilateral triangle. So, since we have two sides of the same length and the angle between them of 60 degrees, this means that if we connect the ends of those two lines, we will form another equilateral triangle. So now, notice this red line in between. This red line actually represents the height of this equilateral triangle. We know this for a fact because this line is perpendicular to the right side of the triangle and it also bisects the left angle. So it must be the height. We can use this fact in our favor. We know that the height of the equilateral triangle bisects its side. And since we know that the side of the triangle is 2r square root of 3, this means that the right side of our newly formed equilateral triangle will be divided into two identical segments of r square root of 3. Alright, so this was an amazing geometric sequence so far. But you know what else is amazing? If you guys like this video or subscribe to the channel for more content like this, this stuff would really mean a lot to me. Alright, so let's continue with this problem. First, let's simplify our image and get rid of all unnecessary information. And just keep those which we need. So, you can notice the diameter of our wanted inscribed circle. This diameter is equal to 2 capital R, and it is also equal to small r square root of 3. So we can say that the radius of our wanted circle is equal to r root 3 over 2. Now, remember, we are looking for the area of this inscribed circle, so the area will be equal to pi capital R squared. And we can substitute the value of capital R and get the following. Now, of course, we can simplify this and get 3 times pi R squared over 4. And now, here's a really awesome thing. Remember before that we saved the value of pi r squared, which is equal to 4? Well, as you can see, we have the same value of pi r squared down here. So we can just substitute this value for 4 and get the following. Now, it's pretty easy. We will just cancel out 4. And finally, we will get that the area of our red circle is equal to 3 squared units, and this is our awesome solution. So, I really hope you guys enjoyed this problem. And if you guys found any other way to solve it, please do not hesitate to write it down in a comment section below. I'm really enjoying the fact that you guys always keep finding the different solutions for the same problems, which is quite awesome. And of course, until next time, see you all and take care.